RDNA3 is coming, and it doesn't need to be better than the 4090 to win. But there is still a fight, and here is what I think AMD's strategy needs to be. See, yesterday the world was introduced to the behemoth that was the Nvidia RTX 4090. In fact, the title of my review was actually disappointed. Why disappointed? I mean, the 4090 was fantastic, and it is. But here's the deal, because of all of the controversy surrounding the announcement of 4000 series, many of you out there, and I mean many of you, and some of us even here at Robeytech, were hoping that, you know what, when it was released, it actually wasn't gonna be anywhere near as awesome as the hype that people kind of expected. Now, if you want the full rundown as to why people are betting against Team Green and you're just kind of new in here and you're like, what are you talking about? I thought everybody buys Nvidia. You're right. But here's the thing. You can watch this video right here, which we recently released, about some of the recent business practices slash dealings that Nvidia has really been doing that seem to be pretty anti-consumer. See, the other one worth watching, I know you're like, what are you talking about, Robey? Why would you promote another YouTuber's videos? But that's the thing, is we're kind of a community. So you should check out this video from Jay's Two Cents, where he talks about the artificial scarcity practices to help keep GPU prices controlled due to the overabundance of inventory for 3000 series caused by the collapse of the GPU mining market. And honestly, there's a lot of mired history in there too. Now, for some of you watching this, you might be like, that's just Nvidia keeping themselves from losing a ton of money. And their board partners too, and you're right. See, the thing is, it just doesn't taste good when it's going down. And with so many folks struggling during the pandemic, and when you see brands like Intel, and even companies like Nike, trying to do what they can to keep the costs at around MSRP and prevent reselling within reason, well, you kind of wish that, you know, a company like Nvidia would do the same thing. And speaking of prices, and one more kind of nail in the coffin, so to speak, is pricing from Nvidia specifically. See, this is a chart that Intel created to help illustrate the concern as part of the launch of Intel Arc. By the way, I think this is where the real problem is. And that's just the cost of the most affordable cards, the ones that the majority of folks are purchasing, and they're slowly, okay, maybe even not so slowly, starting to creep up. See, this is what needs to stop, because the cost of our very awesome hobby of PC building and gaming is already pretty expensive for most folks. And to raise the barrier of entry to be even more expensive would only hurt our industry and stunt the growth of the hobby we all know and love. But here's the deal. When I released my review of the 4090, which is an incredible card, by the way, and Nvidia should absolutely be proud, we saw a myriad of posts, both on my review and so many other similar reviews, about the fact that RDNA3 is going to be either A, or it's gonna do B, or whatever it is to beat the 4090. And then, you know what, I sat there for a while. I went to Starbucks, I drank a latte, I browsed my Discord, and I pondered the universe of GPUs. And no matter how much I spun it in my head, no matter how many times I wrapped my brain around it and I looked at it, I came to the same conclusion. Here's the deal, guys. AMD does not need to beat the 4090 to really win the war. That's not the battle that has to be won if AMD is going to help create real competition and move the needle, so Nvidia has to react like Intel did in the CPU space. I mean, sure, if it did happen, that would be great for AMD and many of you AMD superfans. And I agree, it would also knock the folks at Nvidia down a few rungs. But to really beat Nvidia, to really make a difference, AMD needs to hit it where it really hurts. And that's in the mid-tier to entry-level GPUs that are in like the $200 to $400 range. Because sure, all of the 4090s sold out at launch, within minutes, by the way. But the volume of cards at the mid-tier sold versus the tier that is the 4090 and 4080s is, honestly, it's night and day. See, this is one of the reasons why those launches have a tendency to be so much later, because they need to have a lot of cards on hand to keep up with the volume. And why during the great GPU shortage of 2020 and 2021, the first cards to become readily available were 3080s and 3090s, because the rest of the cards were flying off the shelves due to the demand and volume. AMD knows that too. And how do I know that? Well, because of Intel Arc. Whoa, wait, what, Robey? I mean, I don't understand. Why does knowing about Intel Arc tell me that AMD knows that? Because their marketing strategy is so similar to what I'm talking about. That's why the Intel Arc came out competing at that tier and why they talked so much about keeping the cost at that tier so low. Well, what does that have anything to do with AMD? Well, guess what? Guess where all of the people who came from Intel Arc came from? That's right, a ton of folks from Radeon jumped ship to help Team Blue do the exact same thing that Team Red is trying to do. Take a piece of that lucrative GPU pie, but also to ensure that the world of DIY and pre-built PCs continues to hum along nicely. Why do they care? Well, see, you need to remember that though, yes, Nvidia has a massive stake in the GPU market, both AMD and also Intel have the CPU side of things they need to keep healthy. So when an outside force, let's say Nvidia, starts to control and cause disruptions with climbing GPU prices, then jumping in with options to help control costs for consumers just makes good business sense. Higher GPU prices means less people can afford them, means less people are buying parts, which includes CPUs and GPUs from Intel and AMD. And I know in some ways there's an oversimplification, and yes, there's a lot more, but for the sake of this video and not making it 3 years long, the point is you can follow my logic and get to the same conclusion. At the price point of $250 to $400, every dollar up or down matters, especially when it comes to people's purchasing power at that range. Wait, Robey, here, okay, so I'm following you, I get it. But I watched your video on which one to choose, which you can check out right here, that placed the ARC, the RTX 3060, and the AMD 6650 XT all against each other. And when you look at the data, well, you showed it was all kind of about Team Red. And you're right. See, Team Red showed up very strongly in both the value and the performance aspect. And yes, it would make the most sense to purchase one of their cards either over Intel or over the Nvidia RTX 3060. But here's the deal. There is definitely a stigma to AMD, especially when it comes to GPUs. People have strong feelings about their drivers, they have strong feelings about their feature set, and even how they compare to Nvidia that is keeping them from buying the GPUs. And I mean, let's be honest, even during the shortage, you could readily basically go in and buy AMD GPUs in most cases. And in so many ways, it was better in pure performance and it was actually better and cheaper than the Team Green counterpart. See, part of it is actually an education problem. See, I did a video recently about the 6950 XT and the Radeon Adrenaline software, and the amount of comments from people being surprised about what was actually available and what you could actually do with the card was actually staggering. And that's even for folks who own the cards already. See, the other is actually history. See, AMD was plagued by bad drivers, especially at the launch of the 5000 series. And I mean, you don't really need to look too hard to find the evidence of people complaining. They have gotten a lot better. I mean, even Linus mentioned in his review of the Intel Arc cards that AMD drivers and software have matured like a fine wine. And not a cheap box fine wine, by the way, like a really good, like $15. Oh, okay, $25? $50? Okay, well, you know what, however much a fine wine cost, but it's not perfect still. I mean, our tech team wanted to throw the Radeon 6950 XT through the window because the dang thing kept having hangs on state changes, and we actually had to reinstall the drivers 3 times over the course of our 7 hours we spent with the card. Something we just didn't have to do with Nvidia. And again, those were pre-release drivers from Nvidia. See, but now it feels like AMD has like a moment to really deal a strategic blow to Nvidia and the Jensen Brute Squad, and maybe put a dent in that like 3,000 pound like black leather jacket of his. It's like, ka-ching! I mean, that thing has gotta be bulletproof. It is so thick. All eyes are on November 3rd when they step on stage and announce to the world what's really happening with RDNA3. So here's what I think they need to do or should do in order to be successful. Number one, they can't ignore the little guy. There's no room for the pomp and circumstance around their flagship GPU. Sure, everyone is gonna wanna know what's gonna go on with the Battle of the Titans, but right now, all of the normal consumers, those of you who are out there who basically said, hey, I'll sell a kidney for a 4090 or, you know, my kid needs to eat, they're looking at the last generation of cards for their holiday PC dreams, and they really don't have a clear path to follow. See, Intel Arc, unfortunately, I would say had a less than optimal launch experience. And it feels really limited to consumers. Even though I would argue, yes, Linus did a 9 bajillion hour stream and people were like, run this game from 1976 or this game from two, the games, a large historical amount of DirectX 9 titles. And I would even argue that some of that stuff is artificially limited for consumers. And you know what? Here's the deal. I do actually believe that Intel Arc will be a real option for consumers in the future. And maybe in many cases, actually already is. So an announcement from AMD, even a roadmap of what is happening for their 7600 XT and 7700 XT would be a welcome guidepost, almost like a path that folks could latch on to and know if buying a card now or when the mid-range cards are coming, or entry-level cards, and that would be an awesome consumer-friendly thing to do from Team Red. It's harder for AMD here because Nvidia is silent about what's happening below the 4080 12 gig, and you know what? Strategically so. There is a glutton of cards available and an inventory for the 3000 series, and Nvidia doesn't want to threaten selling those cards at a good price. See, here's the deal. An announcement from themselves on 4060 or 4070 price and performance could actually jeopardize that. Remember, this is a weird world for them, where the 3000 series and 4000 series are going to coexist. But also, if AMD announces that in November, despite Nvidia's silence, that they have these cards coming, and they can sway consumer confidence and show that the value for this new 7000 series generation with AV1 and all of the bells and whistles for DL, you know, for FSR and RSR and ray tracing and everything all, and all that stuff is unmistakably in their favor. Rasterization, you name it. I think you could see the masses making the switch to AMD, and Nvidia would absolutely have to react in a good way. Number two. They absolutely need to talk about improvements to their software and improvements in their stability. What's their answer to Nvidia game day drivers? How much more frequently they're gonna update when there's issues? And what are the larger improvements to stability? They need to have folks that are outside of their stable. They've had so many circumstances where they said something is one thing and it hasn't quite been there. But you know, maybe have folks from like the Microsoft Windows Compatibility Lab who are third parties talk about how much better their drivers are. You know what, and I dare even say this, pay YouTubers like Steve from Gamers Nexus, Hardware Unboxed, and Linus, people who are bigger than me, yes, I know, my name's not in there, but have them do unbiased stability tests to help show that there is improvement. See, people are looking for reasons to make the change. I mean, so many comments down there of like, man, I wanna go AMD, or I'm looking at this, or I need the excuse. They need reasons to believe that AMD is a safe place for gamers and give them like bastions with the support of data to help educate via word of mouth, the improvements, and allowing folks to point to places and videos to show that the data is real, not provided by AMD, but also so they can sit there and say like, look, here are my favorite outlets and they went and proved that it's actually successful. Number three is AMD Advantage. See, it started with resize bar, and then in the mobile space, we're already seeing what kind of performance uplift we can get from the multitudes of technologies that AMD has created when you have the synergy between your CPU and your GPU. AMD, and now also Intel with Direct Link, I mean, it's like they had the same team members working on their stuff. Both Intel and AMD are uniquely positioned to provide one thing Nvidia can't, and that's utilize the combined architecture of CPU and GPU across the entire breadth of your PC. Things like smart access memory, utilizing the Infinity Fabric, etc., are all things that only AMD can enable with other AMD technologies. That stuff Nvidia can't. And where we, luckily the consumers, could see some super surprise performance gains over Nvidia GPUs. It's just like that moment when AMD announced with RDNA 2.0, resize bar, when pairing a CPU and a GPU of the same brand, in this case AMD, would actually improve gaming performance. And everybody was like, that's cool. Unfortunately, or somewhat fortunately, depending on how you look at that, Nvidia realized that everybody could do it, that it does exist, and then once they figured out that AMD figured out how to enable it, they did so too. But here's the deal, Nvidia reacted. So if AMD could find something proprietary here, and they already have it, right? It's in their mobile space. they could push folks to not only get AMD GPUs, but also Ryzen 7000 series CPUs, and ultimately help force a price war from Nvidia to help keep things competitive for them, because they need something, and AKA could be price, to help make people purchase Nvidia GPUs. And finally, number four, yes, I'm not gonna go on infinitely. And I know, honestly, this probably seems really obvious, but they need to have real price for performance comparisons, and more so at the low to mid range of cards than necessarily at the high end, specifically around their GPUs. In other words, I need to pay as little as possible for as much power as possible. If the 7900 XT doesn't quite beat a 4090, that's okay, especially if it only costs $999. But even more so is that if the 7600 XT crushes a 4060, and like the current generation, like what we just showed in that video we referenced earlier about the three competition between ARC, Nvidia, and AMD, if it does it for $100 less, AMD, like Intel, has to be cheaper to gain market share. And if they can do that with also being at parity, which means same, or even better, even more powerful than Nvidia, then we could see some market share changes and also honest competition between Nvidia, AMD, and also hopefully Intel. I know, guys, that there are gonna be other features and strategies from AMD that people would like to see. And sure, they may be important to some consumers, but they don't have anywhere near the mass adoption potential as the four items I listed and covered. Things like power consumption and AV1 are important and they're cool, but neither of those are gonna bring in gamers en masse, because let's just be clear, not every gamer is a streamer, so they don't care if their stream looks 15% better than what it did with the NVENC encoder or H.264, or if it's running at less wattage than an Nvidia card. Power consumption is way more niche than people think. I mean, it's the thing that AMD folks are touting. It's gonna be more performance for less power. But guys, despite the bajillion memes about needing to hook like a direct line to the sun to power an Nvidia 4090, they had no issue selling out within minutes. And there was way more stock than the last time. But it is exciting though. It's a prime time, folks. And I really do believe all of us wanna see what is happening on the CPU side between Intel and AMD happening on the GPU side with Intel, AMD, and Nvidia, where people have an honest choice on the GPU side. Just like you can pick up any awesome CPU from AMD or Intel and pretty much know that you can feel good about your purchase, because in the grand scheme of things, and I know this is gonna piss both sides off, they're pretty close to the same. AMD has a real opportunity to shake things up on the GPU side like they did with Intel on the CPU side. And Lisa is an incredible leader. And I really hope come November 3rd, we all get to watch it happen. Because realistically, Nvidia is playing their own game. And I wouldn't be surprised if AMD factors very little into how they do what they actually do right now. And I think that is very telling. But what do you think? Do you like the four things I listed out for AMD to nail come November 3rd? Would you add something else to the list? Are you considering getting an AMD card this year? And if so, what would it take to sway you? And what was it that's holding you back? I would love to know all that and more down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, you see that like and subscribe button? It's just staring at you, like longingly. Well, why not press it so you can know when we're gonna post more videos just like this on my thoughts and insights, or when RDNA3 actually comes out, or when we cover the launch of 13th gen from Intel. The other thing too is, do you wanna see live RDNA3 builds, or heck, even 4090 builds? Because we're really excited about those too. I mean, that card is awesome. So you should come and watch those, because we have a live stream channel. It's actually the big brother of this channel, Robeytech Live. And you can check all the details down in the description box so you can like and subscribe there and not miss our builds that are every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, and Saturday over at twitch.tv/Robeytech or live here at youtube.com/Robeytech Live at 5 p.m. Pacific time. Do you want to talk more about RDNA3 or AMD or any other tech-related content? Then jump on over to our Discord server over at discord.gg/Robeytech. We have other tech and PC enthusiasts that love to chat about these very same subjects. Also, all of our data is shared there. So if you wanna go, you know, check it out, you could actually go check that out as well. So when we compare CPUs, compare GPUs, and you know what? Honestly, you also might make a friend. Now, did you see this fire video of us doing a 60-second review of the 4090 over on our Instagram reel? Or maybe this TikTok about the latest 4090 from PNY? See, you could be missing all of that content too, so you should check us out at Robeytech, absolutely everywhere on all the other socials, so you don't miss our daily content we post every single day. daily, every day. That makes sense. Anyway, folks, I hope you really enjoyed this video. I'd love to know your thoughts. Please tell us down in the comments below, and we look forward to seeing you on the next one. Thanks, guys.